7:43, Radio City Talk. Good morning, I'm Steve Hothersall. Tony Scott's here from the Liverpool Echo. Morning, Tony.
Good morning, Steve.
Nice to see you.
And you, mate.
Right, did you hear this last night at the UEFA Awards and the Champions League draw?
As flies to wanton boys, we are for the gods. They kill us for the sport. Soon the science will not only be able to slow down the aging of the cells, soon the science will fix the cells to the state. And so we will become eternal. Only accidents, crimes, wars will still kill us. But unfortunately, crimes and wars will multiply. I love football. Thank you.
That's Eric Cantona. Had you heard it already?
I haven't, you know.
Absolutely fantastic. So Eric invited a special guest, gets on stage, and they say, Eric, do you want to say a few words? And he comes out with this prophetic stuff. And it is actually the start of it. It's a quote from King Lear. So the bit at the very start where he says, as flies to wanton boys, we are for the gods. They will kill us for the sport. That is paraphrased from King Lear, of course, written by William Shakespeare. He's obviously a very clever guy. But actually, if you listen to it a couple of times, I think what he's trying to say is there's a lot of bad stuff happening in the world. And then his very last line is, we still love football.
No, that's interesting.
It's actually quite nice if you listen to it. You know, do you remember the other one with seagulls and trawlers? And you still can't work it out. You still think, where's he going with this?
But it's one of the most famous quotes ever from a footballer, isn't it? Everyone recognises it straight away. A few people have said to him who have involved in football that he's one of the most intelligent men you'll ever wish to meet in football. And when he speaks about the game, he knows it inside out. And you wonder why no one's ever approached him to be like a coach at a top club. Because he knows the game inside out. He's very intelligent. And it's a shame that he hasn't gone up to that next level. Maybe he doesn't fancy coaching. I don't know. But very, very intelligent. And what a footballer, by the way. He's just unbelievable, wasn't he?
Oh, mega. And he was presented with an award by UEFA last night. Alexander Seferin, the UEFA president, gave it to him and said that he was chosen because he puts his heart and soul into supporting the causes he believes in. But he's almost too clever. I'm not sure a dressing room would understand him. And when he was delivering that last night, the camera panned in on Ronaldo, who was on the front row, who looked absolutely bemused. Like, there wasn't a chance in living hell that he understood what was going on there.
Seen the video with Lionel Messi and Cristiano Ronaldo next to each other. And obviously the lady was presenting, they obviously had a little chat with them. And then when I was watching, I thought, do you know what, that's some... that duo there, you're never going to see that in the next generation of football ever, to see two world-class footballers. I think we're...
What, you won't see it in 50 years, 100 years?
Well, when we see world-class players, we always build them up and etc. But we normally have one of a generation, like the Brazilian Ronaldo and Ronaldinho and Zidane and Cruyff, Maradona and all them. We're very, very fortunate. We live in an era now where there's two world-class footballers. Arguably at the peak as well. I don't think we'll only appreciate it in 10, 15 years' time because I don't think we'll ever see like anything like this again.
Well, they've dominated it for a decade, haven't they?
Yeah.
They've been there year in, year out. And I think Messi's maybe got one more award in terms of Ballon d'Ors than Ronaldo. I don't know whether I'm absolutely correct there. But each year you expect to see them there. And it sort of reminds me of the tennis situation.
Yeah.
Federer, Nadal, Djokovic. And you take it for granted?
You do, because you're living in that generation. And we're quite lucky. If you look at numerous sports, and I know generation moves on and sport gets better and quicker and everything else and the professionalism outside and inside the sport. But I think we live in a generation now. You could say Tiger Woods involved in golf. You could even go to the entry for the Grand National. You're never going to see a horse win back-to-back Grand Nationals since Red Rum. You could go through every sport that we're currently in at the moment, Floyd Mayweather in boxing. We are living in a generation where it is the best you're ever likely to gonna see. I think we're very, very lucky and we don't appreciate it more now. You could go to every sport. You could go from darts to Phil Taylor a couple of years ago, horse racing, boxing, cricket. we're very, very lucky now that we are seeing top class balls in this generation.
It's just a shame Messi won't be able to speak like Cantona
in the future when he comes on.
Anyway, Virgil van Dijk was the top man. I know you'd be delighted about that.
Oh, yes, of course.
And he was absolutely unbelievable. And I was sort of thinking, how's he won this award in terms of points? So here's the top 10. Virgil came top with 305 points. Lionel Messi, second, 207 points. Ronaldo only got 74 points. Saudi Omani actually came fifth in the list with 51 points. Then Mo Salah, sixth. Eden Hazard, Matthias de Ligt, Frankie de Jong, and Raheem Sterling was 10th. And just to explain the voting system, there was the jury comprising of 80 coaches of the clubs that participated in the Champions League and the Europa League. 55 journalists added on to that. Jury members picked their top three players. First player received 5 points, second three, third 1 point. Coaches couldn't vote for players from their own teams. And that's how those points were accumulated. And Virgil van Dijk was the top player. And that was the right choice.
Yeah, yeah, of course.
I mean, even from a Liverpool perspective, I mean, you look at it and you think, well, it should be from a... does it have to be from a team that wins the Champions League?
It generally is, isn't it? It generally is.
And if that suits UEFA as well, doesn't
it? Of course it does. If Liverpool wouldn't have made it through from Barcelona in the semi-final, I can't see Virgil van Dijk winning that award. Mm. If Liverpool get knocked out at the semi-final stage against Barcelona, that doesn't happen. It's very, very... In fact, you could go through all the records of since this award's been handed out. I think you'd have got to be a winner to be in it. Listen, you can't complain. Virgil van Dijk's been one of the best players this season. Now, for him, going forward now, dominate it for the... I know it's going to be quite difficult for the central defender to do that, but now put yourself in the picture for the next 10 years, like Messi, like Ronaldo, them types of players have been in the pit. Even if
almost impossible.
It is for the defender, but... put your surround, make come third 1 year, fourth year, put your second next year. Make sure you're at that top bracket for the next 10 or 15 years. I'm sure he's got the capabilities, there's no doubt about it. But that's what makes world-class players to do it for a consistent basis throughout. Not just to be a flash in the pan for 18 months. Now, 2, 3, 4 years, built. Obviously Liverpool are building something. Now's your chance to dominate world football for the next 5 or 6 years.
What a cool trio. Messi, Ronaldo, Van Dijk. And actually, when there were some pictures of Van Dijk and Alisson standing on what looked like the harbour side, and they looked like Brad Pitt and, I don't know.
Wouldn't you have got all that money, by the way?
So like movie stars, don't they, these days?
That's the way they're built up now, aren't they?
Also, well done to Alisson, who got the goalkeeper award. So well done to John Achterberg and everyone who's helped Alisson collect that in his first year as well. So that was the UEFA awards last night. And the Champions League draw is pretty much handed easy groups to all the English sides.
Yeah, yeah. You look at it, and I think Chelsea, in terms of what they've got, I think that's a tough one for them. But I think Manchester City will be happy. Liverpool will be happy. I think they couldn't have handpicked better draws. Napoli, they know about from last season. You've got Red Bull Salzburg and Genk. You listen, that wouldn't look out, excluding Liverpool out the game here, you look at them other three opponents and they wouldn't look out of place in the Europa League. So I think Liverpool have done well there, picking a nice group there, and they should be topping it. And when they come to the last two games, they should be already through by the time they've got a couple of uncomfortable fixtures during that FC Genk game and the Red Bull Salzburg at home. So I'm sure Liverpool will sail through that. But then again, last season we thought that, didn't we? And Liverpool made it tough for themselves, didn't they? They lost all three away from home and they were sweating on the last game, having to win 1-0 against Napoli. So I can't see Liverpool not going away and taking 3 points in any of them games. I think Liverpool will be fair favourites to win that one.
Yeah, Man City are the favourites to win the competition overall. You mentioned Chelsea. They've got Ajax, Valencia and Lille in their group. I was talking before and saying, for me still, and this is just me, I prefer the Champions League. I'm very much a Champions League.
It says the Premier League.
Yeah, very much. I always have been. I don't know what it is, a certain affiliation, affection for the competition, the way it resonates perhaps globally as opposed to nationally.
But don't you think if you win the Premier League, that just literally catapults you to...
I don't think the Premier League is recognised in the same way the Champions League is recognised globally.
I think Premier League is...
Robbie texted me as well. He said Champions League all day for me as well. I would imagine...
You've seen it twice.
I would imagine I'm in like a small 5% bracket. Yeah. But that's only because historically the club haven't won the Premier League for such a long time.
So I understand where you're coming from, but when you haven't won the league for so long, and that's the one... 99%, excluding yourself, want to win.
I don't think even 99%. I go 90%. I think there is. I think there's a lot of people who do enjoy the Champions League.
It'd be interesting to see if there's any Liverpool fans out there that want to get in touch that what they want to win this season more than anything.
Well, but you'd say more than that. Look, because they won the Champions League last season. Of course, I'd like them to win the Premier League. I would have liked them to win the
What would you prefer? If I could say to you...
I just enjoy a great Champions League run. I think I enjoy that run more than the Premier League run sometimes.
What's tougher to win?
Well, it's tougher to win the Premier League. Of course it is. And again, this led on to the debate with Matty before about the fact that Pep Guardiola, we can all say, would have preferred to swap the Champions League for the Premier League. But I think as a coach who works day in, day out with his players... I'm pretty sure he was over the moon to win the Premier League.
Of course.
Because it represents his day-to-day work.
And I think Brian Clough once said there's a YouTube clip, and he was asked a question by John Motson a couple of obviously when he was in his pomp at Nottingham Forest, and he says, what do you want to win? Because obviously Brian Clough was winning leagues and European Cups, and he said, what do you want to win? And he said, league. That's your bread and butter.
But it's so very different now, isn't it?
Because there's more money.
The landscape's just changed completely.
No, I disagree.
And I think in 10 or 20 years' time, I think football will be in a very different place. And I think there will be more of a global playing field for it.
There's more money involved in the Premier League than the Champions League. Surely. It tells you everything you need to know. That's your bread and butter. Your league, over 38 games, you can show your management skills, your players have got it through all types of season, your autumn, your winter, your summer, whether you can hack it for 38 games. That is a test of endurance for any side. Now, there's Liverpool there last season, won the Champions League and lost three games in the group stages. I'm not taking anything away from Liverpool in the Champions League last season. I'm not. But you don't need to be a fantastic side to win a cup competition. You know that.
I wouldn't have swapped that Barcelona game for anything.
Of course. Of course, that's what memory's about. And I totally, totally agree. But if I were to ask the majority of Liverpool fans out there today, going downstairs, what would you prefer, Premier League or Champions League?
What would be really interesting would be, say they'd won the Champions League last season and the Premier League the season before. I wonder what they'd be saying then. I wonder whether that would have narrowed it because that's the reason I'm trying to make. I'm trying to say, I understand it because of the longevity of the gap of having not won it. But actually, if they'd won both, where would your head be then?
I think Liverpool fans would go for no.
I think the Champions League runs it very close, personally.
We'll see.
Let's get on to Everton. Lucas Digne with a wand of a goal the other night. I don't think you see a better free kick than that all season, do you? Anywhere across Europe.
I'm worrying about Lucas Digne
because his stock's too high, isn't it? Yeah, it's much too high.
I'm not discrediting any football club. He wouldn't look out of place at any team at the moment. Yeah. And we had this debate on the All Together Now podcast last night. Currently, for me, he's the best left back in the country. I know Andy Robertson's fantastic footballer, but I look at the opposition. You've got Zinchenko and Chilwell and Mendy and Luke Shaw and Danny Rose. Lucas Digne for me, and Andy Robertson's fantastic. There's not much in between them currently, and I'm saying this on this.
Digne scores more, does he?
Lucas Digne scores more. He says set pieces, and what you tend to forget, Steve, is that when Andy Robertson crosses that halfway line, he's got Roberto Firmino to pick out. He's got Mo Salah to pick out. He's got Sadio Mane to look for. He's got all these world class footballers. Lucas Digne gets past that halfway line, and there's Dominic Calvert-Lewin in the box.
Oh, come on. You've got good players there.
Oh, yeah, of course. But look. Yeah. No, seriously. Look at the type of the calibre of footballers Andy Robertson's got to pick from. And now look at it compared
to... That doesn't detract from the work that he does, though, does it?
No, I'm not disputing that. For me, as in an all-round player for goals, for creating chances from set pieces, defending as well. If you look at the defending as well, I could count on one hand how many mistakes Lucas Digne has made since he started for Everton.
I think you will have a problem because I think there'll be some big clubs, big suitors on his tail already and actually come January pushing Everton to see whether they'll break.
Well, I'll make a little bit of a guess here that Everton will make him captain next season.
Right.
Because the importance of him, and he shows a lot of it.
Shows great passion, doesn't he?
He does.
Like when he scored that goal, to me, I was looking at his face and thinking, wow, this is a guy who properly believes in this football club.
Oh, yeah, and he gets it. And I think there's a little bit of a French contingent there now at Everton with Schneider and et cetera, and he's involved in that. I looked at last week against Aston Villa, and then Yerry Mina was getting involved in a bit of a scuffle with Wesley of Aston Villa, and his head was gone. You've seen Lucas Digne go straight over and try and grab him away. That's it. That's what a captain should be doing. And I look at it and think, Lucas Digne's played for Roma, Barcelona, Paris Saint-Germain, all these world-class football clubs. He's 26. Yeah, he's still got his best years above him. So I think Everton will... I wouldn't be surprised if Everton tie him down on a new contract. They'll give him the captain's armband, because we're seeing a little bit of a balance now where Seamus Coleman could be gradually be getting edged out the team now. We've seen since he'll be there during the week that there's a possibility of that. So then you go and don't forget Gylfi Sigurdsson could be shaded out the team this season as well, because Everton will be looking to play the 4-3-3 with Iwobi. So I'm unsure whether you're going from captain to vice-captain. Don't be surprised if Lucas Digne's Everton's captain.
Might be the right step. Just very quickly, 20 seconds. Should Richarlison be taking his shirt off in front of the Everton fans?
Yes, there's no problem with that. Why not?
Right.
Why not? Give me a reason why not.
I don't know.
It
didn't bother me, but obviously it's bothered some people, hasn't it?
Well, no, it's bothered fans who say, no, he's turned his shirt the other way round. Well, they haven't got the
They're bothered about the side in which he showed.
Yeah, exactly.
It.
Yeah, he showed the front of it, whereas there was a misinterpretation that people thought he's got it wrong, like Lionel Messi does. Well, he's not Lionel Messi. He's showing the fans that he's playing for the front of the shirt, not the back.
Tony Scott, brilliant. All together now, podcast out.
Yes, out, yeah, of course, as usual, on YouTube, on Facebook, and Twitter.